Hello everyone, thank you for joining us today. This is the first time we meet after the summer break, and I hope that everyone managed to enjoy it given the special circumstances this year. So welcome to the thematic webinar organized by the School Education Gateway, the initiative of European Union, a place to engage with European policy and practice for school education. So my name is Ina, and my colleague Asi are delighted to support this webinar today, which will be dedicated to language education. Today we'll talk about the diverse linguistic and cultural landscape of Europe, as well as discover practices that ensure multilingual education is available to all. So our first speaker, Leticia Cinganotto, a researcher at INDIRE, National Institute for Documentation, Innovation and Education Research, will provide us with the result of INDIRE Language Survey with a focus on current policy discussion on language learning, teaching and assessing. And Professor John Andoni Dunabetia, a researcher in cognitive science of language, will tell us about bilingual and trilingual schools in the Basque education system. Finally, Sabrina Ressum, a vice chair of the Network to Promote Linguistic Diversity, will put a spotlight on the project that is aimed at implementing classroom activities on the European Charter for Regional and Minority Languages. So before giving the floor to our speakers, I would like to point out that the session will be recorded and the recording will be available on the webinar page together with the presentation of our speakers. In the meantime, you can pose your questions in the chat box and we will make sure that we will come back to as many questions as possible in the end of the webinar. So Leticia, if you are ready, I'm happy to give you the floor. You can unmute your microphone and move your slides yourself and start your presentation. Thank you.
So first of all, hello everybody. It's a great pleasure to be here. Thank you to School Education Gateway and European Commission for this invitation. I'm honored and privileged to be here during the week of the European Day of Languages. And it's such a pleasure to see my teachers are here with us today from all over the world. I've seen people also from Mexico and a lot of participants from Italy as well. So it's a great pleasure. Thank you very much. I'm a researcher at INDIRE, which is the National Institute for Education, Innovation and Educational Research in Italy and in cooperation with the Ministry of Education. Today I'm going to provide with some insights about the latest research that we are carrying out in this latest period. I would like to start with this quotation, which is one of my favorite. Monolingualism is a curable disease, and that's why we are all here today to celebrate plurilingualism and the minority languages and all this diversity, language diversity, and in Europe, but also at global level. To give you an idea of the different topics I'm going to deal with today, as I was saying, the latest Italian research that we are conducting at INDIRE in cooperation with the Ministry of Education, so I'm going to talk about first of all our pilot project on CV, which is the latest version of the Common European Framework of Reference, a companion volume published in just in 2000 by the Council of Europe, 2020, sorry, by the Council of Europe. And so we've been piloting a project in cooperation with the Minister of Education on one of the latest, one of the new descriptors introduced by the companion volume, which is online interaction. So we just published a volume in Italian, I'm sorry, but we're going to translate it in the future, collecting the experimentation that we had with schools, with a sample of schools in Italy on online interaction. And always linked to online interaction, we launched a survey in cooperation with the Council of Europe, in particular with Erika Piccard and Ryan Nord, among the authors of the companion volume of the Common European Framework. We launched a questionnaire and a survey on online interaction because we wanted to further investigate this descriptor, in particular during this period of distance learning and teaching during the emergency for COVID-19. And we are going to publish the results of this survey soon. We've been running two pilot projects always linked to the European Commission policies on languages, in particular the Council recommendation 2019. We are experimenting, we are conducting two projects on two best practices, two examples of best practices that are mentioned by the European Commission and in the Council recommendation. One is the plural literacy teaching for deeper learning, which is a project promoted by the ECML, the European Centre for Modern Languages, and I'm the privilege to be involved as a member of the consultancy team in Graz. And the other one is Healthy Linguistic Diet, in cooperation with UCL London, with Dina Memtin in particular, and these are two very interesting project models that focus on language diversity, on plurilingualism, on the enhancement of home languages, and on CLIL. And we are starting from this project, these models that, of course, we've been investigating, we've been and also through study visits in different European schools. We are now experimenting these models on a sample of schools in Italy. The main focus on today's presentation is this survey on languages. The survey on languages that we launched at international level, thanks to the support of School Education Gateway as well, of the European Commission. We designed this survey in cooperation with the European Commission, in particular with Christina Cunningham, that I would like to thank particularly. So it was launched in June and then in August we closed it. So we are still analyzing the data, and we are going to publish a report in cooperation with the European Commission. So this is just some highlights. I'm going to tell you just some of the main results that we are going to further analyze. So first of all, thank to all the teachers that answered our survey. We had a lot of Italian teachers, but of course it was launched at international level, so we had respondents from many countries. So thank you very much. So just a few words about the profile of the respondents. We had about 6,000 respondents, but then only about 3,000 complete answers. It was quite long, so apologies, but there were quite different topics of interest. The teachers were mainly foreign language teachers, and but also foreign language and CLIL teachers, because the questionnaire was addressed to both language and CLIL teachers. And they were mainly teaching at upper secondary level, but also lower secondary education, and then, as you can see, primary education and pre-primary also, some teachers. Then, talking about the home languages, one of the areas that we wanted to investigate was just the provisions for supporting students' home languages in case these were not generally included as foreign languages in the curriculum. As you can see here, unfortunately, only 11% answered yes. So this is, 47% no, and then no. So it's quite a critical, we can say, critical figure, and of course it's an issue that should be further, you know, developed, and that's why, as I was saying, in Italy we are working in this field with specific research projects. Then CLIL. CLIL was one of the areas that we wanted to further investigate because, as you probably know, CLIL in Italy has been compulsory since 2010 in all upper secondary education. And so the Italian Ministry of Education has been investing a lot in CLIL, but of course we know that it's quite popular all over Europe and beyond. So we have 50% of the participants with experience, with CLIL experience. We also wanted to know a little bit more about the CLIL teacher profile. In Italy, for example, the CLIL teacher is the DNL, the subject teacher, with specific, of course, skills, specific training in both in language and in the methodology, in the CLIL methodology. And so we have here quite a balanced situation between subject teacher and both language teacher and subject teacher as the typical CLIL teacher profile. And then also talking about CLIL, the average is one language taught in according to the CLIL methodology, especially in upper secondary school. So as I was saying, in Italy it's compulsory, but also we have a lot of examples also from your lower secondary and primary school. Then another area that we wanted to investigate was the flexibility of the curriculum. So, of course, always referring to languages. The findings here are quite showing some sort of rigidity, we can say, of the curriculum, and not so flexible. For example, we have some questions about first foreign language that could be dropped and exchanged against another language. On against another non-language subject, and we have here, as you can see, no is 78%, 84% is no, so it's quite rigid. While the second foreign language being dropped and exchanged against another language, so here the situation we have a yes with the 36%, so a little bit more flexible in terms of second language with another language, so a little bit of more flexibility exchanging different foreign languages. Another area that we wanted, always linked, of course, to language provision, specific school pathways on languages. That could be, for example, extra curricular pathways that may happen in Italy, for example. So additional hours, maybe in the afternoon or after school, and here the as you can see from the graph, we have 51% yes. So specific pathways focused on language provided in upper secondary school. So it's quite, a good figure. You can say a good finding from this graph. And also very positive is that three languages are taught in this pathway. So it's quite, a diverse, a wide range of language provisions in this specific pathways on languages. As I said, we launched these survey during the emergency, and of course we wanted to investigate the situation about language teaching remotely, and we found out that 97%, so almost all teachers have been teaching remotely during this period. For example, in Italy, after a certain term it was compulsory. There were specific decrees by the Ministry of Education, and so it was made compulsory. We wanted to ask teachers the main challenges in remote teaching. As you can see, oral interaction turned out to be quite challenging, 61%. Of course, oral interaction, as we know, is quite complicated to be fostered, to be developed through technologies, especially peer interaction with peers, and also you know, cooperative group, even if we know that there were so many good examples of activities in breakout rooms and other, you know, other ways, other tools that teachers use to foster oral interaction. But of course, as a general idea, it turned out to be quite challenging. While language skills that they found easy to develop, reading, to develop in remote teaching, reading, of course, reading is quite easy, and also internet offers a lot of inputs and a lot of audio books and other ways to foster reading. But as the overall experience from the teachers' answers, we can say that the students' reactions to remote teaching was quite good, quite they were quite satisfied, 36%. And also teachers said that they could rate their progress. They made some quite good progress despite the challenges, despite the problems that that they had. Then another area that we wanted to investigate was the teacher's idea, the teacher's opinion about possible European language test European test on languages. Of course, thinking about PISA 2025, because we've been involved in the also in the framework of the test that's going to be launched in 2025. As you can see, the idea, the opinion of the teachers is quite quite good. They are quite in favor of a test, a language test, and so 87% said yes. And about the skills that they would like to be tested, we have listening and oral interaction, which is quite surprising, because oral interaction is quite difficult to be tested, as we said, is turned out to be a challenge for remote teaching and learning, and in a standardized test, oral interaction is quite a big challenge, but that's what our teachers answered. And so, of course, these are just provisional data that we are going to further develop and publish in a report, also in cooperation with the European Commission. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much, Letizia. It was very, very insightful. Thanks a lot. I would just to remind to our audience that if they have any questions to Letizia, please don't hesitate to type it in the chat and we will come back to it in the end of the webinar. And we'll go straight to our second speaker, John. John, could you unmute your microphone and your presentation is uploaded.
Hi, hello. I hope you can hear me. So in the presentation that I'm going to give today, I'll try to focus on some aspects of the treatment of minority languages in a place in which bilingualism is a reality, as in the Basque country. We've been bilingual for centuries, and nowadays with the inclusion of curricularly the third language, English in our case, in most of the schools in the Basque country, we have to deal with this reality of being trilingual, or at least trying to be. And it's not been an easy thing in the last years, but we've found a little way thanks to scientifically grounded things that we've found in research. And nowadays we are implementing a small but progressively big changes in the system that we hope that can help others as you, as the teachers that are attending this webinar, to find your own way, always with the support of scientific evidence. I'll try to move this. Sorry if I'm not able. What's the case in the Basque Country? We have a mix of a second, minority, and foreign languages. As you know, we have Spanish as the main language in Spain, but then there are some other co-official languages in some specific regions, as it is the case of the Basque Country, where Basque is the language that some of us use at home, and also it is a language that is being taught at school. And In the previous presentation, we've seen that there's a clear focus on how language is being mastered, so which is the knowledge we have of the language, which is the proficiency levels that we acquire in a given language. But in our situation, it's more about the use and the specific contexts in which the languages are used, because we have had some serious issues with language management. So we've reached, as you will see soon, very high levels of competence in the two languages, but still the use is not as proportionate as it is the knowledge. So for those of you who don't know, the Basque Country is in the north of Spain. It is a bilingual society where these two languages are spoken, but Basque is clearly a minority language. It's a regional language as compared to Spanish, which is all over the place in Spain. And what do the numbers say about the use of Basque nowadays? Well, we have roughly 44-45% of Spanish monolinguals, that is, people who only speak in Spanish. And then we have roughly 40% of active bilinguals. So these are people who are able to communicate and actually do communicate in the two languages, plus a 15% of passive bilinguals, who are people who know Basque and Spanish, even though they actively communicate mainly in Spanish, not in Basque. So that's what the numbers say at the moment. We are talking about more than 1 million bilingual, active and passive bilinguals. And this graph to me is the most enlightening one. As you see, from the 91 to recently, to 2016, the percentage of people who are active bilinguals, those are the reddish bars, has increased progressively in a kind of linear manner. So these are beautiful numbers, thanks to the different linguistic policies that have been implemented in the Basque Country. We've managed to reach a very high level of competence in the two languages, and that's good for all. But the other lines you see here, which are the purple and the yellowish lines, they are about the specific use or contextual implementation of multilingualism in one's home or with one's friends. The numbers have progressively increased, but as you can see from the 91 to very recently, the increase is not as big as the one in the knowledge. So, in other words, we have more people who speak Basque, but the knowledge is not comparable to the use. So still people tend to use Spanish at specific circles or contexts, like with the family or with friends. So this is conundrum that we have, in which we see a disproportionate variance between the increase in knowledge and the not that big increase in the use. Our take is that maybe this has to do with how the school system is being set. And for this, I'm going to give you an overview of how things have been in the Basque school system. At the beginning, when Spain was under the dictatorship of Francisco Franco, other languages different from Spanish were not admitted in regular school. So that was essentially an exclusion for any language that was not Spanish. So of course, Basque was one of these cases, and nobody could speak Basque at the school. Then, more recently, when the dictatorship ended and we entered in a democratic landscape, different models, linguistic models and educational models emerged. We call them A, B, and D. Model B is B for bilingual, and it's essentially based on integration of the two languages within the same context. So imagine a situation in which a kid goes to school, and the two languages can be used. The only thing is that some of the subjects will be taught in one of the languages, and then some others will be taught in a different language. That's Model B, which sounds very logical for a bilingual society like the Basque Country. And then we have other models, which are A and D. Model A is the Spanish-only model. Basque is not completely excluded, because you can find some hours per week for Basque, but everything is mainly taught in Spanish. That's the vehicular language. In contrast, you can see the opposite, which is Model B, in which only Basque is the core language, so the vehicular language, and you can find little hours dedicated to Spanish and, of course, to English as a foreign language. And these are the numbers regarding how many students or pupils you can find nowadays in each of the models, starting from the 90s, in which almost everyone was attending, at least 65% of the students were attending a Spanish-only system. You can see that this number has dropped down to 18% at the moment, and most of our students, our kids, are enrolled in a Basque-only system, so that's the Model D. The blue line is the most paradigmatic to me, because it tells us that from the 90s to nowadays, so 30 years of having a bilingual school system, we've not managed to put more students in Model B, which is the one that, to the eyes of some of us, would be the most representative for a bilingual population. I mean, if we know the two languages and we kind of use the two languages at home or at the street, why not having them also equally represented within the school? Well, this is not the case. Most of the parents send their kids to the Basque-only or mainly Basque-only system. But what if instead of opting for segregation or an integration model, we opt for an inclusion model, a model in which all the languages can be represented within the same school system without parceling out or without contextualizing, without creating diglossic scenarios, so that everyone can speak in any language anytime. What would this mean? What's the difference between integration and inclusion? Well, integration per se is the act of putting something which is from the outside within the system, still in a very compacted way. And this means that they are part of the system, but they are not interacting with the system so much. As you can see with the cartoonist dots that I have created here, imagine a situation in which everything is green. Then you have some diversity, which could be blue or yellow, and you bring them in the system, but still having them as a subgroup of the big group. That's mainly integrating something, but including something or promoting in educational inclusion means that every single color in this case, call it language, call it person, should interact with the others in a relatively free manner. They should be part of the system, and it is now a different system. So it's not about having one system with an addition, but rather changing the system so that the system includes everything and all the agents are part as an equal part. This speaks for respect and response to diversity. It's not part of it's not including this diversity as part of us, but still looking at them from the generalistic perspective, meaning treating them as a minority, but rather responding to them in a very interactive manner in which we all change thanks to this diversity. Inclusive education is not something proper from linguistic diversity, of course. So we can be talking about physical functional diversity, so people with different functional physical needs, or people with different cognitive skills or abilities on psychological states. That diversity should be also accounted for by the educational system, of course, and also socioeconomic diversity. All these responses in an inclusive manner should be promoted. But of course, in our case, we are not talking about linguistic diversity. In order to be able to respond adequately to this situation, we should be, in a way, breaking some rules that have been in the system for quite a long time now. Okay, something is going on with the presentation and tells us that I cannot present you something, but it is very easy. What it was here was essentially the case of a bilingual school, as I have told you before, in which different languages have been integrated, not included, so an integrative point of view in which different subjects have a different language. Imagine a kid that comes to the school and the first subject that this person is taught is maths, and mathematics is in Spanish. Then when the subject ends, this kid will receive a different subject like geography, and geography now is going to be taught in Basque, for instance. And then when this finishes, then it comes history, and history is taught again in Spanish as the first one, but not as the former one. So we go from one language to the other, and from a very general point of view, we would be talking about a bilingual school, because two languages have been represented at the end of the day. But the problem we have is that this is not more than a sequence of monolingual facts. I mean, every single class or every single subject is creating a monolingual context. And then when this monolingual context ends, it comes a different monolingual context, probably in a different language. But this is not more than a sequence of monolingualisms. This is not a real bilingual school as we want to think of. And from the point of view of cognitive science, we want to promote a fully inclusive linguistic model that, thanks to the most recent evidence coming from cognitive science, psycholinguistics, and psychology, cognitive psychology mainly, we can fully endorse models that are based on an inclusive management of languages that allows students or kids to speak in the languages they know in a relatively free manner. But for this, we need to forget about this one language, one subject, one language rule that I just mentioned and that you couldn't see for the Adobe something reasons. So the one subject, one language rule is that has been there in the school system for years, in which you can teach one subject only in one language. But the real question behind this, why? What's the evidence for this? And thanks to some years of studies that we've been developing, not only us, but also many of our colleagues, now we know that science is not endorsing such an approach, that science is much more inclusive and open, giving us the possibility to mix the languages without having any negative drawback of this. And the two critical points that I want to highlight here is that mixing languages within the school or within the subject does not harm learning at all, one. And second, that mixing, sometimes it's much easier for the cognitive system. I am a cognitive neuroscientist. I've been studying the human brain for quite a while, and now I'm putting all this knowledge back to the educational system. And what we are seeing is that talking in different languages, of course, activates different brain areas, and the brain activity is and can be different, but this does not imply that things are more difficult because we are using more than one language. This is not necessarily the case. One thing is brain activity, which of course is higher and different, but then the behavioral result, I mean, how well we learn things, is not being impaired in any form by the mix of languages. I'm not going to give you a full overview of the studies that we've done, but imagine a situation, this was one of the first ones that we did, in which kids and adults are presented with elements, objects that they didn't know about. So as the one that you have on the screen, this is a golden metal piece of something that actually when you see it, you would say, well, no idea what it is. Maybe some of you know, but to be fair, I don't know what it is. And then we give the kids and the adults some definitions about this, because this is what sometimes learning is about, is learning what new things are for or what new things mean. And imagine that you have two languages, language A and language B. A is in blue, B is in red. In one of the big groups, what we did was giving definitions in just one language, language A, which was the majority language. And then in some of the other groups, we give them a part of the definition or one sentence of the definition in the majority language, language A, but also some other part of the definition in language B, which was in this case a minority language. Okay? Result after doing plenty of analysis, including brain recordings, what we saw is that learning was identical in the two conditions. It doesn't really matter whether you learn things mixing majority and minority languages or whether you did it only in the majority language, knowing that sometimes speaking a minority language is not that easy. So despite the difficulty of accessing the minority language, sometimes our participants showed equal amount of learning and they actually did it equally well. So that's the first part of the evidence. And the second one, which I'm going to present in a very schematic way, it's about how we speak and which are the processes behind our language switching abilities and language mixing abilities. So imagine a very basic scenario in which a person is Spanish Basque bilingual, and that person can name things in both languages. So you see a picture of a dog, and you would say in Spanish, perro, and in Basque, you would say, chakur. For the book, you would go, libro, and in Basque, it would be, liburu. So in principle, you could be able to speak, so this person could be able to speak in the two languages, even if this person has some proficiency differences. Let's say that this person has a higher competence of Spanish than of Basque. There is a very, very well-studied phenomenon, which is the language switching cost phenomenon, that tells us that if I ask you to name something in one language and the next thing to be named, I ask you to name it in a different language, there is a cost as compared to a condition in which the two things are named in the same language. Okay, so this is the switching cost effect that has been out there for years and years now, and that we know pretty well, even which are the neurobiological markers of it. So whenever we need to switch because someone tells us that we need to do it, it takes us a while. And this while can be measured in milliseconds and in cognitive cost. But what if we leave participants decide the language in which they want to name the things? What if we don't give them the cue? What if we simply let them speak either in Basque or Spanish in this case? And by the way, this has been also replicated in Spanish and English and in other language combinations in other places of the world. So what happens there? Well, there are two big facts that happen and that are highly surprising. The first one is that people, our kids, our adults, even if they are not that proficient in the second language or the minority language or the foreign language, they decide to switch because both things are active and they simply have to pick the word they want in any language and throw it because they are allowed to do so. Okay, so the first thing is that they do switch a lot voluntarily, spontaneously, and that's beautiful because nobody asked them to do so. And the second thing that was amazing is that if you compute the time and cognitive effort involved in naming something only in one language versus naming elements, so speaking in any language as you want, it is much easier, it goes much faster when you are free to use the languages than when you need to inhibit one language and speak only in the other. That means if you give me the chance to switch languages freely, first, I will switch, and second, this is less costlier for my brain as compared to a situation in which only one language is allowed, even if this language is the well-known language, so the majority language. So mixing is much easier for the cognitive system. And this brings us to the final part. Sorry for the color, something happened to the presentation, but what about translanguaging? Translanguaging is this beautiful pedagogical tool system that we are progressively implementing and using, in which all the known languages at the school can be easily and freely used. So we have a person, let's consider this person a kid, that comes to us as teachers and speaks to us in one of the languages that he and we know. Why not responding in a different language if that other language is also known by the kid? So that's translanguaging, in which you as a teacher or as a language manager do use strategically the languages, depending on the educational needs and the moments, but you leave the others also speaking in all the languages, depending on their needs and the moment. So that's it's an essentially very inclusive manner of using the languages. All of them can be represented, and then when you measure, they are actually represented in the classroom, and it is a very, very respectful treatment of linguistic diversity, including majority languages, minority languages, and also the foreign languages that are taught at the school. So that's why you can also include new languages this way, and with a correct training from the point of view of the teachers and the school managers, this can yield huge benefits for the educational system. I'm very sorry, but again, something happened here, and I cannot see what it was here. But what I remember that I had here was a final note on how to promote this. So the first thing that we need is a correct teacher.
We can switch back to the PowerPoint if you want to, if you would want to see the slide.
Never mind, because.
Okay.
this was the last slide, to be fair. So don't worry. Yeah. No, I was presenting here which are the basic things that we need to keep in mind for a correct implementation of an inclusive linguistic model. An inclusive linguistic model is not created from one day to another. You need to work on this at the teacher training level. So you need to devote time for this at the university, you need to devote time for this at the big policy level, and you need to train teachers correctly. So this has to be done in a progressive manner in which teachers are taught by experts on how to do this and how to use these techniques or adopt these systems. But also, this requires some national, local, and autonomic policies. So we need the politicians to do their job also and adopt some policies that promote inclusive linguistic management of the languages at the school. So if you in your school decide to go this way, and if you have the favor of your managers, that's perfect. But the only way to have something much more meaningful out of this is by including or by asking our governors, our politicians, to adopt national level policies and then to include clean with mixing languages within the school system. It was beautiful to see from the previous presentation that Italy already adopted this line, but sadly, I should say that not all the countries I'm aware of have done this, and this is not the case in Spain, not even in the Basque Country. So that was it, and I'm very sorry that you missed some of the beautiful slides, but thank you so much. It was my pleasure.
Thank you so much, John. It was really, really great presentation. It was very interesting to learn more about this language dynamic in Basque Country. And I apologize for this technical issue with some slides. So we will move directly to the next speaker, Sabrina Rasum. Sabrina, can you hear me?
I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you perfectly.
Thank you very much for having me here, first of all, and for giving us, I mean, to the MBLD and also to the members of this ECA project to be part of this webinar. We will focus again on regional languages, lesser used languages, minority languages, as you want to name them. So this project brings young people and teachers from different language regions together. By looking the way language minority or less used languages is handled in another country, we also find out more about what you feel and think about your own language. And we start from this point of view. And we ask ourselves, we wonder, why do young people in Udine in Italy and in Fassa Valley in Italy still speak a minority language in their schoolyards, for example, instead of just Italian? And what is that makes, for example, Catalan students and Hungarian young students of Romania proud of their language? And this is the point of view we start from in order to present you this project. So I'm trying to... Okay. And we started asking our students, Do you want to cross your region borders with your language, with your minority or lesser used language? And yes, the project bases on the classroom activities of the European Charter for Regional or Minority Languages, published by the Council of Europe in February 2019. This tool is considered to be fundamental in order to present and spread the contents of the European Charter for Regional and Minority Languages at a popular level, among common people and in schools, for example, intending to make all minority communities aware of their rights, the status of their language, and the possibility offered by the charter itself. So schools are indeed the primary institution where constitutional, regional and minority languages are taught, we hope, in the majority of our regions. And they are used at family level, but not always. And so we would like students to look at their regional languages from a metalinguistic point of view and to develop their ability to understand the importance of speaking a regional and minority language together with majority languages. So we decided to work at school level, involving schools and students between 13 and 18 years of five different EU regions, in order to reach the following concrete results. And you can see the result resumed here. So, use and implement part of the European Charter classroom activities of the European Charter for Regional and Minority Languages published by the Council of Europe. Use them in school. Create new possible original didactic tools and new activities to spread the contents of the European Charter for Regional and Minority Languages. And we aimed also at creating a first laboratory of schools working on the European Charter and its contents, and in particular on minority languages. Thus creating a kind of proactive network of schools involved, where the knowledge of the European Charter should become a fundamental skill of students and of teachers, of course, in order for them to know what their rights are. And in doing this, we involved also some universities of regional of regions where minority languages are spoken, because we aimed at creating a kind of pilot activities to be proposed at university courses for students in teacher education, in law and in political science, because we wanted to somehow train teachers who will teach the minority or regional languages. So we started from the point of view that we needed the classroom activities of the Council of Europe to be translated in the regional languages involved in the project. Then we presented this project in some secondary schools, trying to involve as many teachers and classes as possible. And in last November 2019, we had the kickoff meeting in Brussels, where teachers were, let's say, involved in order for them to have the possibility to program together and to go on working together on this project, because we wanted them to be the protagonist of the project. You can see we created this kind of workshops where they could discuss the project and the content they wanted to develop. Then, of course, they started to work in classes, and we also imagined and then developed, we will see later how, meetings among students to exchange experiences about the subject of minority languages and about this issue, and giving them the possibility to use the minority language together with the majority language, in this case English, in order to be able to communicate. The creation of the university models is an issue that is being discussed by the universities involved, and we will see the universities involved, and in particular by the University of Udine in Italy, Friulian minority language. And this will be a tool we would like to share with other universities in other regions speaking regional languages, in order to develop them and to give the possibility to these teachers to be, as said, trained. A last activity of the project is the reporting of the phases of this project itself through articles that are published on the ECHA webpage. I will present you it later, and on the site, the website of the MPLD Network to Promote Linguistic Diversity, that is co-financing the project, because all the minority communities involved in this project are members of the Network to Promote Linguistic Diversity I am representing here. You can see this was one of the pictures of this meeting where students could, sorry, teachers could work together. So in this project we have 7 partners and 5 languages, minority languages involved. We have Ladin, Frisian, Friulian, Magyar in Romania, and Catalan. So Ladin in Italy, Frisian in the province of Friesland, of course. Then we have the Regional Agency for Friulian Language and the University of Udine. I have already talked about it. For Friulian, the Partum Christian University for the Magyar community in Romania, and Sorsa Vives Universitas for Catalan. These partners were asked to involve as many schools and as many teachers and students as possible in the project. You can see here the schools. We have, in fact, 15 schools involved with about 500 students. And the number of students depends on the number of speakers in regions, of course, and on the availability of the teachers in participating in the project, being available to collaborate and to work with us. All the activities are present in a web page we created for the ECHA project, and we guess it is the unique page on the web presented in 5 lesser used languages plus English, and we are somehow proud of this because, in fact, minority languages here are protagonists, and you can see all the results, and I invite you to enter the link and to see some of the results of the project, because, in fact, it is a work in progress. Yes, okay, let's see. Now, the activities at school. So each school has organized and is still organizing the activities on the topic of language diversity in its own way, according to the sensibility of the teachers involved. Because, as already said, we are convinced that it is fundamental to involve teachers and to encourage them to be protagonists in the issue of minority languages, because sometimes they feel not to be ready to present something in their own language, minority language, because they feel they don't know enough about it. But they are the first protagonists, and we are working with them in order to create these didactic units. So teachers, as you can see, used different approaches to the topic. For example, United in Diversity, as you know, the slogan, and they started from here. In Italian, for example, they considered all the minority languages in Italy recognized by the state and the national law, and they started to discuss about these. Then, students were also asked to somehow think about their feelings towards their language. Who are you? What's your language? What's your identity? Of course. Here you have the translation in English, but they worked on these in their minority languages, of course. Or they use, for example, memory in order to inquire somehow the content of the European Charter for Regional Minority Languages, or to be more active in somehow understanding the meaning of being part of this minority community that works and lives together with majority languages. So we had a lot of activities, and others are being developed now, as you can see. And we also asked students to approach the language from an emotional point of view in order to encourage them to come out with something very original and that is near their hearts and their families and their experience in language, because we are convinced that only in this way we can promote the use of the minority language, because it's your roots, in fact. So, other projects, you can see here the Catalan students, some of the Catalan students working on the on minority languages and working on their own language. But the core of this project is a video contest. This video contest aimed at selecting some students who could participate in the exchange program we had programmed for this spring, but because of the COVID it couldn't be developed, and it will be repeated, let's say, or proposed again next year. But in order to do this, we encourage the students to create videos in their own languages with subtitles in English, with the question, what does your language mean for you now and in the future? I selected one of these videos. I can't show the video to you now, but I think you will have the possibility to enter the webpage and go through the videos and understand the participation of the students in their language. And I chose some sentences of a video of a Magyar girl of Romania, who is somehow expressing what her language means for her. So, to me, it means red, white, and even green, the Hungarian flag, of course. It means the goulash soup, the kidney cake, the spring, the shepherd with star eyes. But sometimes it means yelling, escaping, the pain that burns our throat because we feel ashamed of our mother tongue. But I'm still here, I am here, because it means pride, freedom, and fatherland. I think it's not necessary to add other words, because this really expresses the feelings that these students have towards their language. And you will find a lot of videos like these. So, we, as I told you, we couldn't have this student program exchange in spring of this year, and we will repeat it in 2021. We will ask students to use their language and to participate in the meetings in their languages, because the point is that they should understand the way of life of other communities, because through this video they got the possibility to live in a family where another regional language is spoken. So they will feel somehow connected with this family, even if the language, the minority language, is not the same. We will encourage them to work together to make videos, and you will see the work in progress on our website, or on our webpage, sorry. So, the COVID prevent us to propose alternative activities in order to keep students tuned on the project, and in particular on the exchange program. We asked them to make videos again, to speak their language, to share this on Instagram, on our YouTube channel, and we also, as you can see in these pictures, we also created this COVID mask with the drawings of a very famous Italian artist who is renowned in Italy thanks to his hands drawings, you can see. And here you can see that these posters explaining the measures against COVID have been translated in different languages and have been translated also in the minority language. There is a website of this artist where you can find a lot of languages translated, where the value of language is there also in the moment of the COVID. And we think this can really help us to involve these students in their activities also on the minority language, and to try to make them understand that it's something that makes them rich and not poor, because they have something, let's say, more, an experience inside themselves, they can somehow express in this project. So, the conclusions. So, the ECA project gives means to students to cross the borders in Europe with their regional language. This raises their proudness to be part of a minority language community and to speak the language. The ECA project gives value to the teaching of and in regional language at school. The activities of the ECA project put the regional language near to English and other majority languages used to be able to interact with the partner students. Anyway, the emotional interaction and the sharing of identity and cultural contents make students feel connected also through their own regional language, because they could meet themselves thanks to it. The project is relevant at EU level, we think, because it is using and implementing a tool that has been created by the Council of Europe to support minority language communities. Of course, developing the project, we have also in mind a recent Council recommendation dated May 2019 on a comprehensive approach to the teaching and learning of languages, thus proposing a concrete possible approach to constitutional, regional and minority languages at school. The project, of course, is open and can be reiterated, so we invite interested schools to connect with us if they would like to join, because we are sure that connecting these students and giving them the possibility to meet, thanks to their minority language, they will find this, let's say, greed, and they will see that their minority languages are the same, have the same value as the majority languages they are studying at school. So I think that's all. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, Sabrina, for introducing our audience to this project. It was really great. I believe it's a very nice initiative. Thank you once again, and thanks to our all speakers for contributing to this webinar. And now we have a chance to address some questions. So I'll give it a couple of minutes to type your questions in the chat. So please go ahead. And in the meantime, I could see that there were some questions already addressed during the presentation. So one question is addressed to Leticia. The question is, how was oral interaction so developed during remote teaching, and what methods have been used?
Is this for me?
Sorry, I think it's for me, right? The question.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. So the well, as for the method that we used, we designed the questionnaire with our colleague and with Christina Cunningham. I see she's here, so I would like to say hello and thank you, because we designed the questionnaire together, and then of course we had a sample of teachers to try it out before launching, and now we are analyzing the data. Of course, it's quantitative mainly, but also the some open questions. And of course, I didn't have time to share with you all the results. There was just some highlights. And we are now going to analyze all this data, all this open, you know, the comments from the teachers that are really, really interesting according to the framework analysis theory. And then we're going to publish a full report. And of course, we're going to share with the European Commission, with the CML. So I take the opportunity to say hello to Sarah Bredlin. And I mentioned the CML at the beginning because we are experimenting this project PTL, which is a project promoted by the CML in Italy as well. So we're going to share all the final reports and with all the scientific community and the teachers interested in that. And for the second question about the oral interaction, there are some interesting open comments in the questionnaire, but also we've been collecting experiences in Italy in particular, because we've been, at Indire, we've been supporting teachers in remote teaching and learning with a lot of initiatives, a lot of webinars. And so we had the opportunity to collect all the experiences during this period. Of course, as it came out from the questionnaire, our interaction turned out to be challenging to be fostered in remote teaching. Teachers used a lot of European projects like eTwinning, Erasmus. So in this way, students could get in touch with other peers from other countries and had the opportunity to be engaged in a meaningful, you know, a task, meaningful oral interaction with, you know, to share projects, to share ideas and so on. Teachers used, online, you know, tools like, so webinars like Zoom or other, Zoom turned out to be one of the most popular, in particular, the breakout rooms. So they organized separate rooms so that they could, so that students could interact in you know, in small groups, maybe without the teacher's control. So in order to foster, you know, fluency and to be, so that they could be free to chat, maybe also informally, and then maybe reports, you know, discussions in plenary. And also another very interesting strategy that was used during this remote teaching period was debate. Debate is one of my research areas about the teaching methodologies that we are investigating and in my institute. And debate in writing and debate, oral debate in through the different conference, different webinars, was one of the easiest way to organize, you know, meaningful tasks so that students could, you know, have their opinions to share and to defend and supporting with evidence and so on. But of course, it was a challenge for our teachers.
Thank you, Letizia. And we have another question for Sabrina. Sabrina, one of our guests is wondering, is the project open to new partners and schools?
So of course, it is open. This is a pilot project, and as I said, what we aim at is to involve as many schools as possible in order to give students the possibility to share their experiences and to go on working and to feel that they are not alone in Europe, that we are a lot speaking lesser used languages. So of course, if they want to join, they can write, perhaps you can share the contacts, I think, or they can search for the page, the web page, MPLD, Network to Promote Linguistic Diversity, and ask for these, or write on my address, on my mail address. We can share it if you want. I wrote it on my presentation.
Thank you, Sabrina. Indeed, we'll share the presentation on the webinar page within 2 days from now on, so our guests will be able to access this information. It's no problem. Thank you. One more question for John. There was a wonder, the question about, do you think that local dialects could be considered in a multilingualism path?
Hi. Well, absolutely, yes. I'll give you as an example what has happened in the Basque public television and radio system. Up until now, we have like a unified, so to say, dialect, which is the one that that is mainly taught in different schools, and then different other dialects of Basque. Up until now, it has been this unified Basque has been the one promoted by the public system in the TV and in the radio stations. But nowadays, we have realized that all the different dialects should be also incorporated, because those are part of the richness of a language and of the society. So nowadays, you put the Basque TV or radio station, and you'll see or hear people speaking in the different dialects. So that's part of the richness of a country. Of course, when we talk about the school, it does apply at the macro level, but at the micro level, it's kind of difficult to expect a person to change from one dialect to another, because typically one attaches to a single dialect. But it would be very rich for a school to have all the dialects represented, as the different languages should be also represented there.
Perfect. Thanks a lot, John. So I believe that there are no more questions for the time being. So I would draw this webinar to the end then. So yeah, I could see that there was quite a strong interest in the topic, and also very positive feedback in our audience, which is great. And I thank our speakers for this fruitful contribution to this webinar, as well as our audience today for participation. So that's it. Thanks a lot for joining us today one more time. Have a wonderful evening and goodbye.